Okay. I have a piece of good news for you. I am again experiencing a neurological attack, and this time it's worse than the other time. So I can't afford to waste time. So I'm just going to go through these things a little fast, just see how my this thing is.
Can it be good news for us, sir?
That means I'll be finishing fast. Anyway, let me drink some water. Well, an entire galaxy has joined. Okay. So let's start. The other sources of ancient Indian thought, apart from the Shastras, which I told you, are not religious texts. They are some kind of science, not even alchemy, but proper science. Okay. Alchemy, as you know, is a underdeveloped science, something that is not developed fully, right? But Shastras are not in the nature of alchemy. They are those which are properly scientific. So the Puranas, I was telling you the other day, if you look at the word Purana, though in Sanskrit we pronounce it with an na and say Purana, in Hindi it becomes Purana. Okay, so old knowledge or traditional knowledge about various things are those which come to be called Puranas. I had talked to you about the Garuda Purana, and I had told you that there are other Puranas as well, like the Garuda Purana, called the Vayu Purana, the Indra Purana. Okay, so there are different kinds of those Puranas, which are something which have something more of a cosmological element in them than a sociological element. Okay, and therefore I have not included their names here. Okay, I don't want to make this a class in cosmology. We should be looking at sociology. And politics will come in much later. Okay, because in India, politics never broke free from religion, or in this case, Puranas, or in this case, the Sanatana Dharma thinking or the Buddhist thinking. So we'll say that politics did not break free of philosophy. Politics didn't exist. Okay, only philosophy existed. No political philosophy also existed. Political philosophy perhaps came into being a little bit in the medieval period, and definitely only in the modern period. And this is where I stick my neck out and say that it was Gandhi who is the only real original philosopher from even in the modern period. The rest are all people like Nehru, Ambedkar. All these people are essentially liberal, Western liberal educated. They are not very different from the philosophers that you find in the West. Okay, Nehru was a Fabian socialist. Ambedkar, for all his this thing about the upliftment of the downtrodden. He presided over the creation of a constitution which is based not in anything which is in the nature of community, but is in the, it's individualist. Okay, and I always tell you that what is justiciable in the Indian constitution? Fundamental rights. Those are given to individuals, right? But we also have directive principles of state policy, which are supposed to be ensuring the collective good of people, but those are not justiciable, right? So our constitution is a liberal individualist document. We'll talk about that later, not now, next semester, if I'm still there. So I don't want to talk about the Puranas, like the Vayu Purana and all that, but Sthala Puranas are important. Okay, Sthala Purana is self-explanatory, right? Sthala is a place. Purana is the documenting of the story of a particular place. Okay, so if I talk about how Rajaraja Chola, you know, constructed the magnificent Meenakshi temple and that entire complex which can house 5 Vatican cities, then we are talking about a Sthala Purana. Okay, if you talk about the Rameshwaram temple, okay, the Rameshwaram temple has the highest number of Shivalingas in the world. So if you're talking about the Rameshwaram temple, then that is a Sthala Purana. Why were so many Shivalingas carved out and put there? The main deity is there in what is called the Garbha. Garbha in Sanskrit is the stomach. Okay, so Garbha is where the main deity is, which is the center of the temple. Not necessarily center as in being in the middle, but the main deity being there. But apart from that, why are there so many Shivalingas? Okay, so there is a Sthala Purana there which will tell you the story of Rama. Rama, after killing Ravana, okay, had to atone for a sin. The sin that he committed by killing Ravana was that he killed a Brahmin. Okay, people will tell you, unfortunately, in Osmania University, we go by depiction in Telugu films, where the Rakshasas or the Asuras are shown as dark, and it's just a film depiction. And that has literally, thanks to one Professor Railaya, it has become this thing where, you know, he says all gods are Brahmins and all Rakshasas are Dalits, which is nonsense, because both the Suras or the Devas and the Asuras or the Rakshasas are Brahmins. They are all children of the Kashyapa Prajapati, okay, who was a rishi. He was also a Prajapati, one who ruled people. He had 2 wives, Aditi and Diti. The children of Aditi became the Suras, and the children of Diti became the Asuras, Rakshasas. So it's one family feud which has been projected as something else. So Ravana was not a Dalit, let me assure you. In fact, he is called Ravana Brahma because of the fact that he was a Brahmin. all the rakshasas, all the rakshasas that you see in Indian history or mythology, they are all Brahmins. The gods are not, I mean, by gods, I mean, if you take the avatars, okay, of Vishnu, I'll explain that in a little bit. Vishnu is not a particular person. Vishnu is actually written V-S-N with a dot on the N, U. So that's to be pronounced Vishnu. Vishnu is the all-pervading spirit of the universe. Vishnu is shapeless. He's not somebody who has four arms, 10 arms, nothing. Vishnu is the universe, Brahman. Okay, he pervades. If you are a Shaivite, you are somebody who believes in Shankara, then you say the world is Shankara. Okay, Shankara and both Vishnu and Shankara, Shiva, as seen by Shankaracharya, both of them are seen as Arthanarishwaras. Arthanarishwara meaning that they are Prakriti and Purusha. Okay, so the Shivalinga, if you look at it, is not just a linga, it is also the female genital around it. So, which is the celebration of procreation. So, there's nothing religious about this. It's not at all religious. And if you go to Khajuraho, it is all erotica on temples. Okay, the carvings that you find in Khajuraho temples, they're all erotic. Okay, most temples had, they've removed them because people were embarrassed. My God, this is supposed to be a religion and why do we have erotica? Right? But so if you take Sthala Puranas, you will see that Rameshwaram has so many Shivalingas because Rama had to atone for the sin of killing a Brahmana, even though the Brahmana was unethical. Okay, now if you look at Ravana, the only bad deed that he committed was taking Sita away. Otherwise, Ravana does not have any other deeds which can be considered to be sinful. Right? And even when he took Sita away, he basically did not touch her. He gave her 1 year's time to say yes to him. He didn't touch her. He didn't violate her. So, he wasn't a complete sinner. He wasn't a debauch of a character. And so the killing of the Brahmana and all these Vishnu avatars, starting with Rama, you will see they are either Kshatriya or, you know, the other things. So Rama was a Kshatriya. He was not a Brahmin. Right? And before that, it was animals. Narasimha is half animal, half man. Then you have Varaha, which is a pig, right? And before that, you have Matsya, right? The avatars of Vishnu. And then you have the Vamana, the short man, right? So you have all these things. So now, because he killed a Brahman, he had to atone for it. And his atonement was a prayer to Shiva. And a prayer to Shiva was not enough if he basically did some japam or something which is in the nature of that. The prayer also had to have the pratishtha of a certain number of lingas. Okay, so all those lingas that you see in the Rameshwaram temple, I don't know if you've been to Rameshwaram. I have been there. It's an amazing thing because you can go and take bath in the sea. That's the only place in India where you can go into the sea. Nowhere else can you go into the sea. Okay, because we have a continental shelf. You go in and if you're not a good swimmer, you're finished. But Rameshwaram is a place where you can go peacefully. You can walk a great distance into the sea. Okay, and you can feel the sand all the time. So it's a beautiful place. I also saw the controversial Ramar Setu, which is supposed to be the bridge built by Rama. So that's why it's called Rameshwaram, by the way. Rama and Ishwara, Rameshwara. So there was supposed to be the necessity for the pratishta of a certain number of Shivalingas. And so you have, that is the Sthala Purana of Rameshwaram. Okay, so unlike Madurai, where you had the construction of this grand temple by a king called Rajaraja Chola. That is also a Sthala Purana, but that is very different from the story of Rameshwaram. Okay, and Madurai and Rameshwaram are not very far. You should travel by train if you go from Madurai to Rameshwaram. The bridge is built over the sea and it's a pretty long bridge. So it's an amazing sight traveling by train from Madurai to Rameshwaram. So we Indians aren't too bad at things. You know, we put ourselves down unnecessarily. We do have some good achievements. We constructed a bridge across the sea. Not the Ramar Setu, the other one. The one between the railway bridge is what I'm talking about. Okay, so the Sthala Puranas are there in terms of the Jyotir Lingas. Okay, I have forgotten how many Jyotir Lingas are there. Okay, the Jyotirlinga is where Shiva was not put there by somebody, but it's called Udbhava. Okay, where the Linga came into being as an act of Shiva himself. Okay, one of the Jyotirlingas is in Andhra Pradesh. Okay, and that is called Draksharama. Okay, that is one of the Jyotirlingas. There are number of Jyotirlingas all across the country.
I think 12, sir.
Yeah, 12. Correct. But I was not sure, so I didn't want to look like a fool and say stupid things. Thanks. You've helped me. So, Jyotirlingas are there. And these are supposed to be Swayambhu, Swayam Udbhava. Okay, those are the things. So each of them has a Purana, that is a Sthala Purana. Right? Now you go to Badrinath, that's a Jyotirlinga. Go to Kedarnath, all of them have Sthala Puranas. Tirupati, Tirumala has a Sthala Purana. Right? So, now if you look at Brahmanas is a very funny name. I have been trying to research on this for a very, very long time. I am not getting satisfactory sources which tell as to why these things are called Brahmanas. First and foremost, let us try to understand what Brahmanas are. Okay. Brahmanas are extremely long commentaries. Okay. If you look at most of ancient India, I told you, Sanskrit is a language which believes in pithiness, short sentences. And so everything is short. Even the Upanishads are very, very short. They are two lines which are very short and they convey the full idea. There is no compromise on there's no compromise on the content of what is being conveyed through these short lines. But if you go to Brahmanas, the difference is that the Brahmanas are lengthy commentaries, extremely lengthy, not ordinary lengthy. And they basically relate to Vedic rituals. Okay. Now, what has happened is, now I told you, the reason why I told you that I'm not satisfied with what I have found. I've been researching this for years, not for a few days or anything. Why are they called Brahmanas? Okay, I really don't know. But they have been interpreted by some people who don't understand anything of anything as commentaries written by Brahmins. Okay, they have been interpreted as commentaries written by Brahmins on Vedic rituals, and they have focused upon the idea of animal sacrifice. Some of them have even gone forward a couple of steps forward and have said that there is a breaking of the heads of human beings. So they are unsubstantiated. There is nothing to suggest this in the Brahmanas. So why are they called Brahmanas is still something that I have not found out. I'm still researching. If I find out, and if you leave your email IDs, I'll send you my answer the day I find out. Okay, but they have nothing to do with Brahmins. They had something to do with the way in which rituals are to be conducted. Okay, they describe everything, how, where you have to use a certain kind of dhanya, as they call it, which is grains, food grains, all that things are. Unfortunately, one of my ex-colleagues has interpreted this, given it a fantastic interpretation. First of all, he said, the Brahmanas are nothing but cow sacrifice. And Brahmins were beef eaters. That is the first conclusion he came to. Then he said, with the coming of Buddhism, and when Buddha preached that you cannot eat meat, then the Brahmins had to change their way of life. Okay, so Shankaracharya, when he went taking his message to all four corners of the country, the Shankara, original Shankaracharya, Adi Shankaracharya, he set up four Shankar Mats. Okay, though he was from Kerala, the southern Shankar Mat is in a place called Sringeri in Karnataka. The western Mat, okay, is in a place called Dwaraka. The northern Mat is in Badrinath. The eastern Mat is in Puri in Odisha, the present day Odisha. Okay, so it's there in Puri. So he set up these four. The Kanchi Kamakoti Peetam was not set up by Adi Shankaracharya. Okay, please remember that. Now, my erstwhile colleague, he believed that since Shankaracharya came from Kerala, he replaced the sacrifice of breaking human heads with that of breaking coconuts. Okay, because in Kerala there is an abundance of coconuts, and if you break coconuts, then Kerala's political economy will improve. Okay, Kerala will become a rich state. That is why Shankaracharya introduced the breaking of coconuts. Now, as far as I'm concerned, this is the most ridiculous explanation. There was no Kerala then. Okay. There was absolutely no Kerala. Yeah. And political economy, what are you talking about? Political economy is a Western concept. Okay. It started with liberalism, with John Locke and Adam Smith. You're talking about political economy of Kerala and combining it with breaking coconuts. Anyway, so the Brahmanas are surrounded in all kinds of controversy. And I'm being extremely honest with you, apart from saying that they are lengthy commentaries on all kinds of rituals to be performed during a homam. Okay, a homam is where you put fire. For the ancient Indians, fire is one of the most important things. I told you the story of Rama and Rameshwaram, but you should also see Rama is supposed to have told Sita, after he won the battle with Ravana, he's supposed to have told Sita that you have to prove that. How do I know that Ravana has not touched you? So Sita enters Agni Pravesha, or what people call Agni Pravesha, which is you go into fire, and the fire died. So that was indication that Sita was pure. So fire is seen as a purifier. Even your agarbatti, by the way, the incense, is a purifier. Anything that you see in the form of a homam, where there is this thing happening, that is fire. Right? So it is around this whole notion of fire that you have the whole idea of Brahmanas. Right? So beyond that, I cannot tell you much more. Itihasas, itihas, again in Hindi, it means history. Okay, itihasas here Ramayana is the story of Rama. Okay. Mahabharata is the story of Kauravas and the Pandavas. And it is called the Panchama Veda, the fifth Veda, because it was written by Veda Vyasa. There have been different Vyasas, by the way. But there is only one Veda Vyasa. There is only one Veda Vyasa because this Veda Vyasa arranged the Vedas into the Rig Veda, the Yajur Veda, the Sama Veda and the Atharvana Veda. It was done by one Vyasa whose name is Krishna Dvaipayana. Okay, Krishna Dvaipayana is his name, and he wrote the Mahabharata. The Mahabharata is nothing but the story of the family of Krishna Dvaipayana, or the Veda Vyasa. So that is also an itihasa. Places mentioned in the Ramayana and Mahabharata. For example, Gandhar, from where Dhritarashtra's wife came and therefore was called Gandhari. Gandhar is there even today in Afghanistan. It is called Khandhar. It is called Khandhar. Maybe you were not born then. In 1998-99, a plane was hijacked. An Indian Airlines flight was hijacked to Kandahar. Okay, and that's a different story. But these places exist. Okay?
Yes.
Kurukshetra exists. Kurukshetra exists, as does Indraprastha. Okay? And Hastinapura, they exist. Delhi is Hastinapura. Okay, Ayodhya is not the present Ayodhya. Actually, Awadh, which became Lucknow. Awadh was Islamization of Ayodhya. Okay, and that is the actual Ayodhya, not where our good Prime Minister is building a massive temple. That is not the Ayodhya. Okay, all these places are also then there in Thailand. Thailand also has an Ayodhya, by the way. They write it as Ayutthaya. Okay, they also have those. Anyway, so they can be taken as part fiction perhaps, but they are not entirely fiction. Now, Bhagavata. Bhagavata, people think, is a part of the Mahabharata. It is not. Bhagavata is the story of Sri Krishna. Okay? Sri Krishna, who should not be called Sri Krishna, whose real name is Govinda Shauri. Okay? The Krishnas that we know, the two Krishnas are one, Krishna Dvaipayana that I talked about, the Veda Vyasa. And the other one is Draupadi. Draupadi is called Draupadi because she is the daughter of Drupada. So the daughter of Drupada became Draupadi. But her real name is Krishna because she was dark. Okay, people who were dark were called Krishna. The god that we call Krishna is actually Govinda Shauri. And Govinda Shauri was a Yadava. He was not a Brahmin. Please remember that again. He is not a Brahmin. So gods are not Brahmins. Okay? Gods are not Brahmins at all. Rakshasas are Brahmins. And I believe that is the right depiction. Because all the perversions that came into Hinduism came in through the Brahmins. So they have been Rakshasas even after the Rakshasas have been killed. Anyway, so that is the Bhagavata, which is the story of Sri Krishna or Govinda Shauri. Vedanta is the end of the Veda. End of the Veda meaning not the end as in last page. Vedanta is understanding the philosophy of the Vedas. Okay, when you have understood the philosophy of the Vedas, then you have become a Vedanta or a Vedanti. Vedanti is one who has understood everything, so he has complete knowledge. Okay, and you see North Indian names. They have names like Dvivedi, those who know two Vedas, Trivedi, those who know three Vedas, Chaturvedi, who know all the four Vedas. So those are the Vedanta. In the Vedanta, this thing, apart from the Vedas, these are also two other texts. One, which is called the Bhagavad Gita. Everybody knows this. This is confused for Bhagavata. Bhagavata is different from Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is what Krishna preached to Arjuna in the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Right? When Arjuna said, I can't kill my cousins, my grandfather, all those. But this is in the Dwapara Yuga. In one Yuga before that, which is the Treta Yuga. Okay. The Ashtavakra Gita was there. So what is the Ashtavakra Gita? Ashtavakra Gita was the Gita that was given to Janaka, who is the father of Sita. Okay, and that is why Sita is also called Janaki. Right, because Janaka was his name. So sage Ashtavakra, just as Krishna did to Arjuna, he told him the principles of righteousness. So along with the Vedas, you have to include Ashtavakra Gita and Bhagavad Gita in Vedanta. Okay, less than a minute. So time's up. I was hoping to finish this today, but we finish it on Monday and move on. Okay, thank you very much. Bye bye. Say hi to your dog. I love dogs. No, okay, no. Sir. Seriously, the world's greatest animals. They give you love. Sir. Love, love, and sir. Love. That's all they give. I wish I could keep them again.